this film, I wish to tell you about some very beautiful portions of the subjects of differential geometry and topology, so that you can get an intuitive idea for these topics. I shall illustrate them in this film in two and three dimensions, but you should know that they have generalizations to higher dimensions, applications to our knowledge of the universe through the theory of relativity, and form the inspiration for many of the most exciting developments in modern mathematics. I've worked with these ideas for many years, and I hope that you will find them as inviting as I have found them to be. Differential geometry is the study of the properties of curves, surfaces, and their higher dimensional generalizations by means of differential calculus. You will need to know some elementary calculus in order to follow the details of this film. In topology, however, we study those properties of surfaces that are left unchanged by continuous transformations. In particular, in topology, all of these surfaces obtained by deforming a sphere are still called spheres. But there is a topological distinction between a sphere and a torus, for a sphere cannot be continuously transformed into a torus. The purpose of this film is to show you how these two approaches to the study of surfaces are interrelated by means of the Gauss-Bonnet theorem. Let us begin with differential geometry. A central topic in this subject is that of the curvature of a curve or a surface. First, let me talk about curves. Intuitively, the curvature of this line should be zero. On the other hand, this circle is curved, and this smaller circle seems to be even more curved. How shall we express this idea of curvature in precise terms? We shall try to define the curvature of this directed curve C at point P. As a first step, we map C, or a portion of it near P, into the unit circle U in the following way. Draw a unit normal N to the curve at point P. Then move N parallel to itself until its initial point is at the center of the circle. Its endpoint is then at point P prime on the circle. Thus, the point P of C is mapped into the point P prime on the circle U. As the point P moves along the curve C, its image P prime moves along the circle. If P moves along an arc of the curve of length delta S, P prime will move along an arc of the circle of length delta theta. When P moves through an arc delta S, the normal N turns through an angle delta theta. Thus, the ratio delta theta divided by delta S can be computed for every arc delta S of C. The limit of this ratio, as delta S tends to zero, namely the derivative of theta with respect to S, is called the curvature kappa of the curve C at P. For example, if C is a straight line, the image P prime is the same for all points on C. So delta theta equals zero, and kappa equals zero. If C is a circle with radius r, the arc delta S is of length r delta theta. So delta theta divided by delta S is equal to delta theta divided by r delta theta is equal to 1 divided by r. And the curvature kappa is equal to 1 over r at every point. When the concavity of C is away from the unit normal, the arc delta S drawn in the positive direction of C maps into a counterclockwise arc delta theta on the circle. So delta theta divided by delta S is positive, and the curvature is positive. But if the concavity is toward N, a positive arc, delta S, maps into a clockwise arc, delta theta, which is negative. So the ratio delta theta divided by delta S is negative, and the curvature is negative. Since kappa equals d theta ds, we can interpret the curvature as the arc rate of change of the angle between the normal n and the horizontal as the point P moves along the curve. Now let C be a closed curve like this. What is the integral of kappa ds around C? To get the answer, let P move smoothly around C and watch to see what happens to P prime. Since P prime traverses the circle exactly once, we see that the integral of kappa ds is equal to 2 pi. If C is any simple closed curve whatever, the result is the same. The integral of kappa ds is equal to 2 pi. If C is now like this, the integral around C is now, well, what do you think? 4 pi. Of curves, their curvatures, and their other properties is the most beautiful and inviting topic in elementary calculus. But I must leave it here so that we can get on with the generalizations of these ideas to surfaces in three space. I shall now be concerned with the surface S and wish to determine its curvature at a point P. As in the case of curves, we map S into the unit sphere U by means of its unit normals. Thus P maps into P prime. Then, as P varies, so does its image P prime. A patch of area delta A on S containing P is mapped into a patch on U of area delta B. If we now compute the ratio, delta B over delta A, and find its limit as delta A tends to zero, we will generalize the process that we use to find the curvature of a curve. The result is the absolute value of the curvature, K. If S is a plane, every point P maps into the same point P prime, so delta B is zero. Hence, the curvature K of a plane is zero. If S is a sphere of radius R, the area of a patch delta A is R squared times the area of the corresponding patch delta B because of the properties of similar figures. Hence, delta B divided by delta A is equal to 1 divided by R squared, and so the curvature K is 1 divided by R squared. This procedure gives us the curvature to within algebraic sine. To explain the sine of the curvature to you, I shall use another geometric idea. First, draw a normal N to S at P. Pass a plane through N, cutting the surface in a curve C. Then C is a plane curve and has curvature kappa. Now, rotate the plane about N thus obtaining a family of curves through P. In general, one curve of this family will have a maximum curvature and one a minimum curvature. The corresponding curves C1 and C2 are at right angles at P. Their curvatures, kappa 1 and kappa 2, are called principal curvatures. If we now define the curvature of S at P to be K equal to kappa 1 times kappa 2, it can be proved that the absolute value of K is equal to the absolute value of the curvature which was defined earlier. But now we know K including its algebraic sign. If both curves are concave away from the normal at P, as for this ellipsoid, then these two curvatures are both positive and K equals kappa 1 times kappa 2 is positive. But if their concavities at P are in opposite directions, as for this saddle surface, the signs of kappa 1 and kappa 2 are opposite, and K equals kappa 1 times kappa 2 is negative. Thus, if the curvature at P is positive, the surface near P looks like a piece of this ellipsoid. And if the curvature at P is negative, the surface near P looks like a piece of a saddle. If the surface is a cylinder, one of the curves, C1, is a line, whose curvature is zero, and the other is a circle. Hence, the curvature of a cylinder, being the product of these curvatures, is zero. A piece of a surface whose curvature is zero everywhere can be flattened out into a plane without stretching or crinkling. But this is not possible, for example, in the case of a sphere. For a flattening of a piece of a sphere requires stretching and shrinking. If you don't believe it, try a piece of an orange peel. This distinction among surfaces of positive, negative, and zero curvature is closely connected with the properties of non-Euclidean geometries discovered by Gauss and other mathematicians of the 19th century. These discoveries changed man's whole outlook on deductive reasoning and caused one of the major revolutions in the intellectual history of mankind. The concept of curvature can be extended in several different ways to surfaces of 3, 4, or even higher dimensions. One of these generalizations was used by Einstein in his general theory of relativity. In this theory, Einstein linked the force of gravitational attraction to the curvature of our four-dimensional space-time universe. That the notion of curvature depends only upon the shape of a curve or surface in a very small neighborhood of a particular point. We have also seen that for a simple closed curve, the integral of kappa ds around the curve is equal to 2 pi, and that for a curve like this, the integral of kappa ds around the curve is equal to 4 pi. So we see that the curvature is very closely related to certain properties of the curve as a whole. How does this work for surfaces? If we consider this surface S, what is the value of the integral of K dA over S, where dA is the element of area of S? Before we can begin to discuss this question, we must know what kinds of closed surfaces there are. Thank you. This is where topology comes in. You may have heard that surfaces may be two-sided, like a cylinder, or one-sided, like a Mobius band. We shall be concerned with two-sided surfaces only, for integrals cannot be defined over one-sided surfaces. Then it is a theorem of topology that any closed, two-sided surface can be deformed into one of the following. A sphere with one handle, that is a torus, a sphere with two handles, or perhaps like this, or indeed a sphere with any number of handles. That is, every two-sided closed surface can be deformed into a sphere with q handles, where q is an integer which is zero or positive. Since these surfaces may be twisted into quite complex shapes, we need a simple way of finding the number of handles. Let us begin with a sphere. From the point of view of topology, all the regular solids are spheres. For each of these, let V be the number of vertices, E the number of edges, and F the number of faces. And let chi equal to V minus E plus F. The number chi is called the order characteristic of the surface after the Swiss mathematician Leonard Euler, 1707 to 1783, who first used it in his research. For the tetrahedron, V equals 4, E equals 6, F equals 4, and so chi equals 2. For the cube, V equals 8, E equals 12, F equals 6, and chi equals 2. For the octahedron, V equals 6, E equals 12, F equals 8, and chi equals 2. For the dodecahedron, V equals 20, E equals 30, F equals 12, and chi equals 2. And for the icosahedron, V equals 12, E equals 30, F equals 20, and chi equals 2. The conclusion of Euler's theorem is that for any such subdivision of a sphere, chi is equal to 2. Now, what about a sphere with one handle, a torus, which may look like this? It is not hard to show that for a torus, chi is equal to 0. For a sphere with two handles, chi is equal to minus 2. And for a sphere with q handles, chi is equal to 2 minus 2q. So if we compute chi is equal to v minus e plus f, we can find the number of handles and the type of surface confronting us. Now we are ready to put all this together. We saw earlier that for a sphere of radius r, the curvature k is equal to 1 over r squared. And we know that the area A is equal to 4 pi r squared. So the integral of k dA is equal to 1 over r squared times 4 pi r squared is equal to 4 pi. We also know that the order characteristic chi of a sphere is 2. So for a sphere, the integral of k dA is equal to 4 pi equals 2 pi times 2 equals 2 pi times chi. This formula is proved for a sphere, and it also makes sense for any two-sided closed surface. Can it possibly be true in general? Indeed it is. The first proof was given by the French mathematician Ossian Bonnet, 1819 to 1892, in 1841. There is some reason to think that Gauss also knew this theorem, and there is a bit of jealousy between the French and the Germans as to who was its true discoverer. In order to avoid international tangles, we use both names and refer to it as the Gauss-Bonnet theorem. To recapitulate, let S be any two-sided closed surface and K its curvature, then the integral of K with respect to area over the surface S is equal to 2 pi times the order characteristic chi of the surface. This is the Gauss-Bonnet theorem. This remarkable connection between the differential geometry and the topology of a surface is also true in higher dimensional spaces and has been the inspiration for a large body of mathematical research in the last 40 years. As I close this film, I want to encourage you to learn more about these subjects, to study the proofs, and if possible, to try to invent some new theorems in these areas for yourselves. There is still a lot of gold in these hills, and if you can find some, your name will be added to the list of famous mathematicians whose portraits I have shown you in this film.